So, I'm just starting the So, good afternoon, all of you. I, Professor Ghanshyam Rathod, welcomes you all on behalf of EC Engineering Department, BVM Engineering College, on this 1 week faculty development program sponsored by AICT Atal Academy and organized by EC Department BVM. I take this opportunity to introduce the expert of today's second session on IoT-based tiny machine learning. I welcome Dr. Kiran Trivedi sir on behalf of EC, on behalf of organizing team of EC Engineering Department. Let me introduce Dr. Kiran Trivedi sir. Dr. Trivedi sir is a professor at the Electronics and Communication Engineering Department of Vishwakarma Government Engineering College, Ahmedabad, affiliated with Gujarat Technological University, under the Commissionerate of Technical Education, Education Department of Government of Gujarat, India. Dr. Kiran Trivedi is BEC and BE in Communication System Engineering and holds PhD degree. He is having 24 years of experience in teaching UG and PG students at the university level. Dr. Trivedi has organized various workshops on wireless and mobile technologies in India and delivered various expert talks on artificial intelligence, edge computing, and deep learning. He is involved in development of AI-enabled embedded device-based application for health and ICT. He has been invited for talks at national and international level. He had been invited to demonstrate his messenger system to the Honorable President of India, Dr. Abdul Kalam. Dr. Kiran Trivedi has been awarded as Nokia Developer Campaign for the best contribution to mobile technologies from 2007 to 2011 consecutively. He had received the NVIDIA Artificial Intelligence Research Grant in 2018. He has also been awarded as Best Professor for Broader Outlook Learner Teacher and holds AIR India Rank and Bold Award. Dr. Trivedi was a global winner for the OVI App Wizard contest in Nokia Global Calling All Innovators contest in 2010, and he also won Dr. APJ Kalam Innovation Award at IABS 2017 Conference on Biomedical Sciences. He has published more than 35 papers in various conferences and journals. His two patents were published in Indian Patent Journal, and he loved to speak on intellectual property rights. Dr. Trivedi actively organizes ITU Girls in ICT Day for last 2 years and was invited to speak on India's leading FM radio station AIR to promote girls in ICT of rural areas in Gujarat. His team of students have been winners in hackathons at the state level. Dr. Kiran Trivedi has published science and technology related articles in leading newspapers and worked on many innovative projects. In addition to this, he has served in various government committees like TEQIP, Research Coordinator, and Student Startup Innovation Policy Coordinator. Apart from this, he is avid cyclist, riding more than 27,000 kilometers so far, in total of still counting, and loves music also. So we welcome you, Dr. Trivedi, on this second session of IoT FTP. And sir, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Ghanshyam Rathod, for a very exhaustive introduction. Thanks a lot for inviting me for this session in the FDP on IoT and related applications. I hope my audio and video is clear to all of you so that I can start my presentation and today's session.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Clear. Audio, video, both clear.
Okay, fine. So, good afternoon, friends and faculty members. for being a participant in this FDP on IoT. I'm very happy to share one of the interesting area where we have lots of opportunity to work in the field of IoT. We have seen lots of technologies in terms of IoT starting from, so let me share you the screen first. Is it visible to all of you?
No, sir,
not the presentation yet. Visible? Okay, so now it is visible. So as I was talking about that, we have seen so far lots of technologies in terms of Internet of Things, and mainly we have we might have worked on the IoT based applications. Maybe some of the faculty members have worked on various sensors and embedded systems and connecting them. Even some of you might have tried to set up an IoT system with a LoRa wide area network, that is low power, wide area network. So these are some of the things in terms of IoT. But what is a new concept in terms of IoT to integrate machine learning with that? And that is one of the latest concept, which was most probably announced last year by Google, and that is known as a tiny machine learning. So this is not different, or this is not new in terms of machine learning or maybe in IoT. But the important thing is that how you can integrate machine learning to embedded systems specifically for IoT. That is what the main concept which I'm going to discuss today. So let me give you an example. You might have heard about various artificial intelligence techniques and machine learning algorithms and techniques for creating the data set and preparing the model, trained model, and deploying them onto the computer and making some applications based on that. We have seen lots of areas in which people are doing computer vision related machine learning for identifying the objects, or maybe face detection, face recognition, and all of them. So this is a very common process for everything. So in a nutshell, I would like to discuss here is that the ingredients remain same for any machine learning technology, that you prepare a data set. It may be a different data set of maybe images, or maybe sensor data, or maybe audio signals, or maybe any other numbers or alphanumeric characters. So this can be a data set. Once you use some sort of algorithm specifically based on the application, that what sort of prediction you need from your application, that is what the training of the data. You train the data and you get a prepared trained model. So once you get the trained model, you try to deploy it onto your application. And finally, what do? Is that you predict something based on the training of the data set which you have already there, and using that trained model, you get the output of the any input you provide. So that is what the main ingredient part in case of machine learning. Now, recently Google has announced that there is a technology called TensorFlow. TensorFlow was already there since last 2-3 years, but now they have done a little bit more work into the TensorFlow, is that they have brought a TensorFlow Lite technology. So Lite means when you have a low power, low computing device, means in terms of memory, in terms of resources, or maybe the processing capacity is very low, at that time we cannot run all these big trained model of machine learning onto a mobile phone or maybe
excuse
an embedded
me,
system.
Excuse me, sir.
So if you want to run.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, I think a slide is not.
Yes, please.
I think a slide is not.
I have not moved the slide yet.
I think you are.
I can move this. I can move the slide. I'm just creating the base for starting this session.
okay, sir.
So, so what I want to convey here is that the ingredient remains same. That these are the big train models which we usually run on the computers. And those who have worked in the area of machine learning might have experienced that these models are of say 170 MB or maybe more than that. They are a very big model. And if you want to deploy them on Raspberry Pi or maybe any Arduino system or maybe any other ESP32, etc., it is so big. It cannot be. It is not at all possible to deploy them onto the hardware. So Google has brought the concept of TensorFlow convert. So what the main concept was, we have to explain how this goes well for implementing. And if we will have some time within half an hour in the last few minutes of this session, I would like to demonstrate a real world example of sensor data. I will show you how to collect the sensor data and how we can prepare a model for that. So that is what the main concept I'm going to discuss in my lecture today. So we call this as an edge computing. These days you might have experienced that there are lots of edge computing devices in market, and the well-known are like Google Assistant in terms of Google Home, as well as Amazon Alexa and Apple Siri. Apple Siri is not a device, but it is basically a mobile application. But there are physical edge computing devices in the form of Amazon Alexa. Amazon Alexa is the best example of edge computing, and I would like to comment here is that it runs tiny machine learning into that. They have a different technology of Amazon, but in case of Google Home, they are actually running the tiny machine learning on that. And if you are innovative in terms of implementing all these, you can definitely deploy all these onto the Raspberry Pi also, or as well as Arduino Nano even, and even ESP32. So being an electronics and communication engineering faculty, or maybe IT faculty, we can integrate all these and we can make some innovative AI applications on the hardware itself. So tiny machine learning is basically a technology which has a very lightweight artificial intelligence trained model which you run on an embedded system based on the preparation which you have done on the available data, and finally you run it on an embedded system. So that is what the main concept is all about. So let me start with this. It is all about like physical computing. Physical computing is in terms of like what we do is that my microphone is muted.
No, we are getting your perfect voice.
Okay, thank you, sir. So like ML models, machine learning models are getting smaller due to the development in advanced libraries. Why this is the case? Because, you know, like there is a parallel growth of technological development in terms of electronics, in terms of IT and computer. So all these three branches are actually mutually helping each other to grow, and that is why this is all possible. We have Amazon Alexa just because there is too much development in terms of electronics, in terms of microelectronics, VLSI, and parallelly we have computer engineers and IT engineers who are developing various models and various libraries which can run on this sort of small hardwares with having a very low computing capacity and memory resources. And there is always an internet connectivity, and that is why it is known as an edge computing device. So these days we have seen Arduino, even ARM processor or Raspberry Pi boards are getting more powerful these days. And recently you might have observed that even most of the embedded system development companies are making the boards which has basically access to internet, access to Bluetooth, access to run any of the machine learning model onto that. So because there are libraries available for that. So machine learning is moving rapidly towards edge devices like Alexa, Google Assistant, as I discussed. And AI on microcontroller. So tiny machine learning is also known as artificial intelligence on microcontroller. So that is what we are interested as an electronics and communication engineering faculty. We always love to see that when there is a microcontroller, if we can deploy any machine learning model onto that. And they are very cheap as compared to computing. Like you need a very high computing facilities. You need a GPU. You need lots of cloud access like from Amazon and Google. But when we want to run on a computing device which is a very small, very cheap, very low power, at that time we don't need such libraries. And the beauty of edge computing devices, is that even they don't need internet sometimes. So because the machine learning model is already deployed on the device and it can definitely help you in replying or predicting the information what is provided to that. So as they are low power, cheap and small computing devices, it reduces the latency, conserves bandwidth and improve privacy and enables smarter applications. So these days we will come to see that in near future, the machine learning is all going to be transferred to electronics and communication side. And that is why we need to take a lead into this. And I'm very happy that we have this sort of faculty development program by which we are able to learn all these things. And being an electronics and communication engineering faculty, we should definitely promote our students so that they can take benefit of the opportunities in case of machine learning field. So how to kickstart this? If you want to start development in terms of anything, 3BL is latest development board. Yes, RBL 30 sense is that it has everything what do you need. So if you want to make an IoT application, you need not have to go for buying sensors, you do not have to go for any other wireless communication modules to integrate with the Arduino, but the Arduino Nano 33 itself is having everything. So you need simply a laptop where you can train your model later and you can transfer it to the computer. Now the important part in this Arduino Nano is that it has temperature sensor inbuilt on board, it has humidity sensor, it has accelerometer, it has gyroscope, it has magnetometer, it has proximity sensor, it has RGB sensor, that is light sensor, it has pressure sensor even, and it has a microphone on it. So you can imagine that all these sensors are available in a single board. It has a wireless capability, it has a Bluetooth capability, and that is the latest one. That is why it is known as a BLE. BLE is one of the latest Bluetooth standard by which we can have a low power communication for Bluetooth link. And even it can communicate to number of devices all together. Because like in our mobile phones also, we have Bluetooth BLE, which has been implemented. It means that it consumes very less power. So it is said that if you have a button cell kind of a battery, and if you connect with the Arduino Nano, it may last for 1 year also sometime, because it depends on the breathing rate of the sensors, what you have set for, that at how many interval it is actually sending the data to the server, etc. So that is one of the important facility and features provided into this Arduino Nano. And I think the price of this Nano 33 is around 3,500, so 3,500. Maybe still it is available in India, I don't know. But when I purchased 6 months back, it was something around 5,000 with all the custom duties and everything. So this is one of the key point and the key hardware what we are going to discuss, and we are also going to see the demonstration using the same hardware. So I will show you how to use that. So what do you need basically for this? Tiny machine learning is not in terms of learning about mathematics behind machine learning, or maybe learning the mathematics for data science or preparing the data science, how you can filter all those things. These are basically tools and techniques which you can explore later, which you can refine later, which you can even improve later on. But initially, to have a kickstart, you need simply a kind of any code editor. Maybe a notepad is also fine, or maybe any Arduino ID or a Google Collaboratory account. Those who have like Gmail account don't need a Google Collab account, because their Gmail itself provides you the Google Collab account. Google Collab is basically a kind of a cloud-based GPU support from the Google itself. So when you have a big data set, it becomes very difficult to train into our local computers, because we may not have a GPU card inside our laptop or maybe the desktop. And that is why we need support of an external GPU. So if you have any GPU, you can definitely use that computer and you can train your data. If it is huge amount of data, which takes sometimes 2-3 days to process. But if you have a very smaller amount of data, even a normal computer will also do. You even don't need a Google Collab account. So Google Collab is basically collaboratory. The full form of Collab is collaboratory, where you can share your data to Google Drive of your Gmail account. And then it provides you an access from their GPU clusters. There are lots of GPU clusters available for free for all the developers in the world who can upload the data, and then they can run their machine learning algorithms on the Google Collaboratory. Once the training is done of the data, it will give you an output in terms of a pre-trained model, which you can simply download into your computer, and then later on you can use it for your normal PC-based application or maybe for the embedded systems. So these are the things. And you may need some sort of command lines, or if you are using an kind of an Ubuntu or maybe in a macOS or something like that. But usually we have, most of the people are using Windows, so you don't need anything else than that. Simply an Arduino editor, a Google account, there is Gmail account, and any other software which you like to edit your code. So that is one of the things. So in this session, what we are going to cover is that the introduction to machine learning, transfer learning and classification, how to run a model, how to train a model. This is exclusively for tiny machine learning. This is not in a real sense, like how do we do in computers, but basically it is for embedded systems. Then we'll see some sort of gesture detection example, that if you do some sort of gestures or something like that, you train your Arduino Nano and definitely it will find out what gestures you are doing based on the tiny machine learning model, which is Arduino Nano. And then also based on the accelerometer data and everything. In today's webinar, happening under the hood when you train a model and TensorFlow, we are not going to cover that part because that is a different session if you want to learn that, all those things. But what we are going to see that how to run training from the scratch to create a model. So we are going to provide some sort of training to the data, what we will be recording, what common errors you might encounter and how to handle them, how to customize the model by with your data set based on the requirement of your project. So this is one of the interesting book. I will suggest all of you to read and go through them. I think 30 to 40% chapters of the book has been kept open for the users, those who want to read this book. I was lucky enough to get the book directly from the author because we had one webinar and the developer of tiny machine learning technology from Google, Pete Walden, was one of the speaker who actually taught us all these things. And as a gesture of appreciation to all the participants, he has actually shared the book completely in a PDF format. And I'm very much thankful to him for this book. And most of the presentation of mine today has been prepared from this book only. So this is only one book in the world today available about tiny machine learning. And most of the examples are also open source so that you can use it. So he has given the title on the tiny machine learning book is that Machine Learning with TensorFlow Lite on Arduino and Ultra Low Power Microcontroller. So there are other microcontrollers also available, which we can use for IoT applications, and we can run the tiny machine learning, that is basically the TensorFlow Lite model, onto the microcontrollers. So that is what the important thing which we should consider. And now let us start with some of the machine learning concepts, because most of the faculties might not have worked into the machine learning area. And that is why I would like to give some sort of glimpse about machine learning, that what it is all about. So we have come across these three terms very often in last few years, that artificial intelligence, machine learning and deep learning. So these are basically the three concepts of today's era where everybody is talking about. It is not a branch of computer engineering. It is not a branch of information technology. It is not the branch of electronics and communication, but it is basically has a root from the mathematics itself. And mathematics has been given a new frame, and this new frame is known as an artificial intelligence. So computer engineers have developed lots of libraries for the mathematical models, which has been already there since many years, 1973, 1975, there were lots of linear algebraic equation, which has been transformed now into a machine learning library. So statistics, linear algebra, and number of mathematical things which has been ported into computer libraries. And that is why it has become the subject of everyone today. If you look at the MBAs right now, they are also into business intelligence area. So some students are interested in doing MBA, but nowadays they have option, apart from finance, marketing, they have option to choose business intelligence. In the business intelligence, they actually teach all these data science and artificial intelligence and everything, that how they can improve the product by using the available data they have. So this is a very interesting field today, what we have. But just to give you an idea of comparison, this is one of the very popular photograph which you will see in everyone's presentation. So this is by NVIDIA actually. They have actually tried to explain that artificial intelligence was early artificial intelligence steers the excitement in 1950s, 60s and 70s. And now it is machine learning because of it has started flourishing in after 80s. And after 2010, we have deep learning, where there were lots of breakthrough happen, and because of that, deep learning is basically the subset of machine learning, and machine learning is the subset of AI. So AI is by and large a very broad area in which there are lots of things covered. But mainly what people are focusing today for mainly the computer vision application is that deep learning is one of the popular technology which is being used everywhere in most of the CCTV cameras or any mobile phone cameras or maybe in computers. We see that deep learning is one of the area which has covered lots of applications. So AI is the science of making things smart and intelligent. Actually, the race of human is to make devices smarter like human beings. We want to port, we want to transform the human intelligence to the devices. Specifically in case of IoT, we want to make IoT devices smart and intelligent enough that they can feel everything like human beings. Say for example, right now I'm sitting, the temperature, if somebody switch, there's too much no air in the room, or maybe there is the smoke in the room, identify and understand, because we have senses, and by these senses we feel and understand, and based on the observation we have some sort of brain activity which is happening inside the brain, and because of that we take some actions, we open the windows, or maybe we switch off the AC, or maybe we switch on the fan, etc. So what we want to do in case of IoT applications is that we want to actually make them smarter like human beings. So sensors are there, they are actually capturing the sensor data at every second, or maybe every half a minute, or maybe at 1 hour of interval, depending upon the breathing rate what we have set in the IoT application. But the important aspect is that how we can make it smarter. Previously we had we used to do some sort of conditional programming into the IoT devices, that if the temperature goes beyond 40 degree there should be an alarm or something like that. But nowadays, we want to make it more smarter like human being. Say, okay, we don't want to do that sort of alarm, that it's a false alarm sometimes, but we don't want to do that. And that is why we want to transform intelligence to these edge computing devices. And that is why we are here for this IoT machine learning applications. It is not the subject, as I told you, of all these branches, but it is the subject of all. Human intelligence exhibited by machines, that is what we are trying these days into IoT devices. And it is the broad term for getting computers to perform human tasks. And here in this case, we are not even talking about computers, we are talking about the IoT or embedded or microcontroller system devices. So the main approach, what we do in case of artificial intelligence is using machine learning. It is one of the approach to achieve the AI, that is artificial intelligence. A field of computer science that uses statistical techniques to give computer systems the ability to learn with the data without being explicitly programmed. The difference between normal conditional programming and the applications what we use in case of machine learning is that simply we are not explicitly programming the whole devices. It is smart enough that it will take the decision based on the requirement itself. Simply telling you that if you have a temperature, say for example, in the morning time, if it is below 20 degree, maybe you want to convey some message that it is a good morning, for example. So based on the temperature, you can definitely wish something like that, but it is not always true. If it is a conditional programming, then definitely all the time it will greet you even in the daytime also, like it is a morning time, but that is not the true. But an intelligent system can definitely understand what is the reality and how to greet based on the intelligence which has been ported to the machine learning model and the IoT device. So machine learning is a technique for using computers to predict things based on the past observations. So past observations are nothing but the data what we have provided so far to the system. And these data are basically useful for predicting something. Just to give you an example that, say for example, when a kid is very small, he's not able to even walk, maybe just 1 year of small child who is starting, who is on the verge of learning walking. So what will happen? That maybe he's moving and reaches to a staircase. So maybe as a parent, we always stop them. Please stop there and otherwise you will fall. So we try to give some training to them, and based on that, it will stop. It will not move. But if somebody is not there to look after, then definitely the kid will fall down from the staircase. And now he learns that, okay, if I will do this in the future, then this would be the scenario of the worst situation. And that is what basically the training is all about, even in case of data or maybe in case of computers or in case of IoT devices. So that is what, definitely I will share the presentation later on. Somebody has actually sent a message. So traditional programming versus machine learning, what is the difference between them? In traditional programming, we have the same system of data and program, and there is a computer and we get some output. But in case of machine learning, what is the difference is that we have data, we have the output also, we have the computer, and we actually have the program as an output. So what do we do in case of it's predicting all these things? So this is the little bit difference of machine learning and the programming, conventional programming. Now, coming back to the very important topic of the presentation is basically a deep learning. That is a technique for implementing machine learning, and it uses convolutional neural network concept mainly. It's a multi-layered artificial neural network. Again, all these technologies are not new. We have already studied everything in the mathematics. Basically, learn regressions data. So, in a nutshell, what we do in case of machine learning is that we actually try to find out the information from the data. We want to use this information, like valuable information from the data, and we want to take some decisions. And that is why, if you might have attended recent data science program which our college has organized. The main concept of the training program was to simply explore that how to change the thinking for data to bring out some decision. So based on the requirement, you can definitely get the results of your interest from the data available. So in this case of IoT, we have sensor data mainly. So how you can train this data so you can get the result as per your requirement in terms of taking the decisions. And this is one of the example of convolutional neural network is basically a CNN architecture by which we see that there is an input layer and then there is an output layer and there are some hidden layers between them. So hidden layers can be 32, 64, 128 or more than that, or maybe a repetition of all these layers. So based on this artificial neural network, ANN, which has been derived from the real human neurons, and the replica of that, it is known as an artificial neural network, and based on the ANN, there are some new concept which was previously developed that is known as a convolution neural network. And using this convolution neural network, the important thing is to provide the input data as a with the features of the data, and finally we get some sort of prediction. So predicting something is the main task. Predicting something was the main task in any of the machine learning techniques. If you look at this neural network where we want to predict a kind of a handwritten data. So if you write something like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., and you want to predict them, how our eyes actually look at all these data. That is what the important concept of convolutional neural network was developed. One of the scientists, I forgot the name, but who actually won the Nobel Prize for human visual cortex, that he actually invented that how the data is processed. We never remember anything, but we actually process the data on the visual cortex, and finally the information goes to the brain and we are able to understand and identify everything. Let me give you an example. Let's say, for example, I have a Bluetooth headset right now in my hand. Even if I show a part of this to anyone, that what is this? So definitely somebody will be able to answer that it is a kind of a earphone or a headset or something like that. Now the thing is, why we are so much accurate? Why we are so much accurate in terms of predicting anything? Even if I show that this is a glass, maybe it's my spectacles, and if I show a part of that, then definitely you will be able to see that. Even if I hide everything and if I show only the stick of that, definitely you will be able to understand and identify with almost 99% of accuracy that it is a spectacles or maybe a kind of a glass which anyone can wear. So why we are able to predict everything with so much accuracy is that we are not actually storing or recording any information, but we are actually recording the features of anything. Features means like there are lots of features of any object what we see. If you look at the apple or a banana or maybe an orange, we see that there are lots of features, the color, the texture, the size, the weight, and everything. And even there are lots of other human sensories also, which actually provides an additional support to our brain, by which we are able to predict everything very accurately. If you close your eye and if somebody puts an apple into your hand, you will be definitely able to feel that by just by the touch, that it's an apple maybe, or maybe by the weight of that, or maybe you are also even able to identify that if it is an artificial apple of plastic, then you will be able to understand that this is not a real apple, it's a plastic apple, or maybe something like that. But we are not able to, but we never give the prediction in terms of general sense. Let me give you another example, that if I show this, like this is a mobile phone, right? So if I show what is this, so answer would be mobile phone. Somebody will definitely give a very answer with a higher accuracy that it is a, say, Nokia phone, or maybe an Oppo phone, or maybe an Apple phone. But we never reply with that this is a black rectangle. It is a black rectangle, definitely. It is a black LCD, definitely it is right. It is a glass which is having a black color. It is also a annual answers, the right answers. We try to give the highest, the answer with the highest answer, because all the featured informations have been stored in our brain, and that is why we are able to predict the things very much accurately. And this is what the main concept of machine learning or a neural network, that we want to provide the feature as an input. So in this example, you are able to see that there is a 7 which is handwritten. So when the 7 is actually divided into 3 RGB structures, and finally we pixelate and we run some sort of matrix on that, we actually transform all the features from one convolutional neural network layer to another layer, and finally we get some sort of mathematical calculation, and we get to see that some features are there. So the main task of this sort of neural network is that by processing through all the layers, we get one mathematical value. So that is what the main fundamental concept behind the neural network, that for every object, for everything which has been provided as an input, we get some sort of mathematical value, which is somewhat, in a sense, it is unique for everything. Even it is written in a different way, even if it is shown in a different way, like 7 can be written 1,000 ways, but everybody will be able to understand that it is 7, because in English we write 7 in number of ways. But as a human, we are able to identify, even by looking at the captchas also, we are so much accurate that it is 7, because in captcha, most of the characters are written in a very different manner, in a tricky way, that it even takes time for us to identify. But as a human being, we are so much intelligent that we identify that it is a number 7 as a digit. So why? Because that happens because we have seen so many 7 digit in our life, and that is why we are able to predict that. If you ask any child who has learned, who has just started learning 7 or writing 7, sometimes he may not be able to predict well, because he has not that sort of experience or that sort of training, and that is why we are not able to do that. The similar thing happens when we talk about human intelligence. Usually we say that humans are so much intelligent animal on the world, and we are able to do everything what we can, and we have so much complex intelligent brain. But what happens when we see a fruit which we have never seen in our India? Say, for example, in past few years, we see that there is a dragon fruit available in the market. So now we know that it is a dragon fruit. But previously, when it comes for the first time in the market, we have to ask, what is this fruit is all about? What is the name of this fruit? So once we know that name of the fruit, we know that, okay, it's fine. We have seen a photograph of zebra in our childhood books, that Z for zebra. We have never seen, maybe many of us might have never seen the zebra in the real life. Maybe in the zoo, many of the people might have seen that. But even the real zebra comes in front of us, we are definitely able to find out that. Why? Because we have seen that zebra. We have never touched the zebra. We have never seen that in our real life. But our brain has all the textured information in terms of the feature has been stored. So when it comes in front of us, we are so much fast and quick enough to gather the information, to identify and to correlate with that. And finally, the output of this layer, like neural network, we get some sort of output value that, okay, this is the zebra. It is not a horse with black strip, but it is a zebra, definitely. So we are even intelligent enough to distinguish between those things. So an example of deep learning, that in this example, when the information is provided, say for example, from the bottom line as an input pixels, there are some visible layers, then there is a first hidden layer. So it actually identifies the edges of the image. So the same thing happens inside our visual cortex, that it looks for the edges. Then it looks for the corners and contours, like that is the second hidden layer, for example. There may be n number of layers in the convolutional neural network, but just to understand the concept of this, we have the various hidden layers. In the first, usually first hidden layers, the edge detection is happening. Secondly, we have some corners and contours which are identified. Later on, we identify the object parts, what are into that, and finally the object identity. So when something comes in front of the computer camera, which is running a machine learning algorithm, or maybe in front of our eyes, we are able to identify everything based on this fundamental concept. And that is why it has become so much accurate and popular. If you look at the image processing concept in our electronics and communication, we used to do lots of MATLAB programming, and we used to play with the images. And maybe if you want to develop a kind of a technology using image processing on MATLAB, that we want to identify the gender of a person, just so you do some sort of image and find out some. There are lots of also published based on that to identify the gender detection. Constraints into that, you need to measure the distance between two eyes, the distance from forehead to chin, and even the eyebrow distance and everything. And there are lots of papers available in the market by which you will be able to understand them, but they are not so much accurate when it comes to different photographs, which your program will not work to identify the gender of a person. So when it comes to machine learning, you have lots of photographs of male and female, and you train them, and definitely it will be able to identify that whether the person is male or female just by the photograph. Even I have tested that you keep your hand in front of your face and just show the forehead, even it is accurately identify whether the person is male or female. There is no logic behind just by looking at the forehead, but the system has been trained so far in terms of accuracy that it gives you the perfect result. So these are some of the examples of deep learning. So again, coming back to the slide, that artificial intelligence is the broader category under which we have machine learning and under which we have deep learning. So all these words are actually used interchangeably, and everything is right, whatever you talk about, whether it is deep learning, but it is very specific. So types of machine learning systems, learning style. So how do these systems learn actually? There are two different ways. I am a self-made man. Self-made man means I have never been trained by someone. Somebody says that, okay, no, I have got some very good mentors and I have got some very good teachers in the school. And there are some people who have never gone to the school. They are illiterate, but they are very good in terms of doing business in our today's era. That they are basically the people who have got unsupervised training. Supervised training is basically you have a grooming session. You go to the training, you go to school, and you go to colleges, and finally you get some degree and you become a professional. But there are people who actually learns everything by themselves. So as a human, there are lots of aspects in our life that we have combination of supervised and unsupervised learning. If you look at our childhood memories, usually our parents take us to market and they show us everything, that okay, this is a vegetable market, this is potato, this is tomato, and we learn everything. But sometimes if we go to the market, we try to understand it our own, that what is this, what is the name of this particular thing, and then we learn everything. So we actually train ourselves by at our own. That is basically the unsupervised learning, that based on the experiences we learn, that is unsupervised learning. But whenever everything is given already, it's like spoon feeding. I would like to give you the example of Dr. Chandresh Vitlani, said that he gave a very good example in the data science course, that the spoon feeding is basically the overtraining, and sometimes it makes your model saturated, and that is why it will never perform well. And it is something like simply, there was a case when one student was asked to bring a postal stamp from the post office of 1 rupee. So he went there to the post office and asked for the postal stamp. So the postmaster said that it is not there, but I have a revenue stamp. So bring that. So he brought that 1 rupee revenue stamp. It's not going to work for that particular task of sending a postage. But the thing was simply was looking at the stamp of 1 rupee. So that is basically a kind of a over spoon feeding. That is what the main concept these days, what we see in students also sometimes. So supervised learning is basically providing all the details, all the data to the system. We give everything, we label everything. Say for example, in today's session, I will show you an accelerometer sensor data that it has three different axes like AX, AY, AZ. So acceleration in acceleration in X, Y, and Z direction, angular motion in terms of X, Y, and Z, magnetic field data in X, Y, and Z. So we have different positions and different movement of the sensor, and we get all this data. So when we record all this data into an Excel sheet, we actually label them that this is the acceleration in the X direction, this is the acceleration in Y direction, this is acceleration in Z direction. So we have fed actually with the label. So that is what the supervised learning. We are actually giving the system is about the data with the label. Now we will see that now give me the output more. And it will be able to identify whether it is the movement in the X direction or Y direction or Z direction. So it is basically the supervised learning. But when you give an example of an unsupervised learning is basically some sort of identifying some sort of similar data out of that. If you record accelerometer data like AX, AY, and AZ, and when you plot them on a graph, you will be able to understand that, okay, all these data of acceleration in X direction or all these data of acceleration in Z direction are falling onto this part of the graph. It means that they are similar. Then you can provide some label. You never know that it is X or Y or Z, but you are definitely able to differentiate them. So it is similar to, again, going to vegetable market and bring some vegetables. Ganivara, Shakwala, Super, all they mix all together, everything into the one bag. But we sort all these things like Tindora and Bindo and Guar and Alag Alag Kariye. So just by looking at the texture, the shape, size, and everything, we try to separate them. કદાચ નાના છોકરાને કામ આપ્યું હોય કે આ બધાની અંદરથી એક સરખા છે જુદા પાડી દો તમે સો હી વિલ બી એબલ ટુ ડુ ધેટ જસ્ટ બાય લુકિંગ એટ ધ શેપ સાઇઝ એન્ડ સો લુકિંગ એટ ધ ફીચર્સ ઓફ ધ ડેટા એકચ્યુઅલી વી ડુ ક્લસ્ટરિંગ એન્ડ વી ડુ સેપરેટ ઓલ ધીઝ ઇન્ફોર્મેશન એન્ડ ફાઇનલી વી આર એબલ ટુ અન્ડરસ્ટેન્ડ દેટ ઓકે ધીસ ઇઝ ટાઈપ એ ધીસ ઇઝ ટાઈપ બી એન્ડ ધીસ ઇઝ ટાઈપ સી સો ધીસ ઇઝ ઓલ અબાઉટ અનસુપરવાઇઝ લર્નિંગ ઇન ધ ડેટા સો સુપરવાઇઝ લર્નિંગ ઇઝ બેઝિકલી ટ્રેનિંગ ડેટા ઇઝ ઓલરેડી લેબલ્ડ યુ આર પ્રોવાઇડિંગ ઓલ ધ ડિટેલ્સ ટુ ધી ડેટા એઝ અ લેબલ સો ધીસ ઇઝ અ ડોગ ધીસ ઇઝ અ ડોગ ધીસ ઇઝ અ કેટ એટસેટ્રા એન્ડ ધેન યુઅર કમ્પ્યુટર યુ આસ્ક ધ ક્વેશ્ચન વોટ ઇઝ ધીસ સો ઇટ વિલ ગીવ યુ આન્સર લાઈક ધીસ ઇઝ અ ડોગ બીકોઝ યુ હેવ ઓલરેડી ટ્રેન બટ ધ ડિફરન્સ ઇઝ વાઇલ ટ્રેનિંગ વી યુઝ અ ડેટા સેટ વિચ વી નેવર યુઝ ફોર રિયલ વર્લ્ડ એપ્લિકેશન ફોર ટેસ્ટિંગ ઓર ફોર મે બી ઇન ધ રિયલ ટાઈમ એપ્લિકેશન the unknown data will appear in front of the computer and that is why it will give you the right answer. Otherwise, it will be a simply remembering or memory kind of a, it is something about storing the data already inside the computer's trained model and it will give you the accurate answer. So in case of unsupervised learning, the machine learning from an unlabeled data set, we are actually not providing any label to the data, but we do some sort of clustering. In this example, in the photograph, there are three dogs in one cluster, there are three cats in one cluster, and based on that, the computer will be able to identify that, okay, there are some similar features into these sort of images, there are some similar features into the cats images, and that is why they are category one or cluster one or cluster two information, and based on that, it will be able to give you the information. So, I would like to comment here is that machines are dumb, still they are dumb, even though artificial intelligence, so much accurate systems are available, but it is all dependent on the human if we give a different label. So in this case, like say, for example, the supervised learning, during training, if you give the label of cat to all the dog data set, and if you give the label of dog to all the cat data set, whenever a cat will appear in front of the computer camera or maybe the CCTV camera, it will call it as a dog because you have trained it wrong. And that is what the same thing happens in our real life also. That is basically the wrong training. wrong training give always give you the wrong result, and that is why the training is very much important. In India, we specifically look for lots of AI problems and machine learning problems just by influence from US research agencies or US universities. We never look at the problems of India, but we try to actually follow them, what they are doing. If all of them are doing on autonomous vehicles or identifying the path on the road and something like that, we try to develop that sort of autonomous vehicle in India. But we never look at the problems of Indian scenario. There will never be any cow on the road on US roads, maybe, for example. So that their models are different, our models can be different. So here we need to work too much on the data set. Usually we don't do that sort of work in the data set. I've seen many PhD students also that they want to do some sort of PhD on AI related areas, but they don't spend much time on creating their own data set. Let me give an example of Canon Research Center in Bangalore. They were making some sort of applications for the CCTV camera to identify lots of things from the Canon camera itself, which are installed into the CCTVs. They took 2 years to prepare their own data set by sending their employees to different places in the world and collecting their own information. They did Google, but actually the data set preparation of the truth you have. Using our own data set actually help us to design the system well. Let me give an example. There is a very good data set available for human gesture detection. Gesture is basically kind of like what we smile, we get angry, we get disgusted, we are excited, we are confused. So we have lots of facial expressions. And based on these facial expressions, we are able to identify whether a person is happy, disgusted, angry, confused, or something like that, or whether the person is normal. So there is one university in US, I think Carnegie Mellon University has a data set of human facial expressions. If you download all these data, you will find that for single expression, like if a person is smiling, you will find 500 photographs of the same person smiling, 500 photographs of the same person having disgusted expression, 500 photographs of the same person having anger expression. And there are 5,000 different people having all these different photographs of in terms of 500 for each category. If you download the data set and if you look at all the facial expression, you will come to know that even people in US don't know how to get angry. So in India, the anger facial expression is totally different than what people have in US. So if you use the same data set and if you use it in Indian market, and if somebody gets angry and you want to find out the facial expression of that person, your system will not give you the accurate result. Why? Because we are using the data set of different people. You should have a universal data set which should run for any sort of problem. So if you are focusing some geographic applications, definitely we should work for our geographical data only. Based on the location where we are living, or maybe the continent in which we are living, then definitely it will work. So I will request all the PhD scholars, if they are doing their PhDs and working on AI areas and are having some work in the case of data set, I would suggest you to work for at least 1 year to prepare your data set. And based on the data set, your work will be very smoother, and you will get more success into your work just because of the data. Otherwise, you need to work very hard in modifying your code and algorithms and everything. So that is what the main concept of data and supervised and unsupervised learning. So what do we get in terms of machine learning as an output? Regression is the basically kind of a thing for predicting continuous value. So if your data is a continuous data, you should go for regression. You can do classification also by predicting some sort of class or label like cat or dog. Clustering is most similar to other examples like identifying different products in case of Amazon example. Sequence prediction, like you want to predict the next word. What we do in case of Gmail, when we write and reply an email, based on the previous text, it will actually predict the next word or sentences. That is a natural language processing concept in the machine learning, and it basically helps you to predict the next word, and it will allow you to fill out automatically. So that these are all the outputs of the machine learning systems. Some use cases of the machine learning is that object recognition, speech and sound detection, natural language processing, prediction, translation, etc. I would like to give you a best example today of today's session is that using the same Arduino Nano, which I'm going to use today, has an inbuilt microphone, and there are lots of COVID speech data set available today. Many of the university has made them open. You can download those coughing sound from these universities' data set. They are having a data set, say, for example, severely infected or maybe normal or a normal coughing or not having infection or something like that. There is a pneumonia, then their coughing is different. You have a normal cough and cold, the sound is different. So there is an inbuilt microphone on the Arduino Nano itself, which you can use to predict this sort of sound samples, and you can, based on that, you can give the output. So if you have made a wristwatch, for example, using this Nano, Arduino Nano, which I have right now in my hand, if you are able to see my video, I'm showing you right now. So if you wear this here, and if somebody in your room actually is having a coughing sound, definitely it will glow an LED over here, because it has a facility to program the LED also on the board itself. So if it is an infected person and coughing something, it will identify that the person is having a COVID infection. So these are some of the case studies which you can even deploy onto this sort of small hardware. So Benjamin, have time?
Yes, sir. We are having time up to 2 p.m., sir.
Okay, thank you. So it is a model, can be mathematical representation of the real world process. We try to actually use mathematics for everything in case of machine learning. To generate a machine learning model, you will need to provide training data to machine learning algorithm to learn from, and finally you will get some sort of trained model. Now there is a difference between training versus inference. Inference is basically you have something already developed and you want to use that directly. So inference is basically the process of running data through the model to take prediction, while training is the process of the machine learning algorithm that builds a model of the system based on the data we provide. So in case of Jetson Nano, that's a embedded system, a microcontroller kind of ARM-based processor on that, which is having a facility to run machine learning algorithms onto the embedded system itself, because it has inbuilt GPU on that. Usually in Arduino, on Raspberry Pi, we do not have GPU because they are very small devices, very low computing devices. It does not have much memory even to write a program. The flash memory is also very small. But in case of Arduino Nano, it has inbuilt GPU on that. So even you can do training on that. In today's example, while using the Arduino Nano, we would not be able to train the data on the Arduino itself. We would be doing training in the computers. We'll be downloading the model and we will load that model because it is a light model. But in case of our Jetson Nano, which has the board provided by NVIDIA, it's costing around 9,000 rupees, available everywhere. It's a very good, one of the leading board in the world today that helps you to make embedded system and IoT systems based on the machine learning. Even you can train your data on that board. So TensorFlow, as I've discussed you, that TensorFlow is basically a high level API provided by the Google itself. For the developers, it is open source and anyone can use it. So we have seen that we have lots of scalar vectors and number of quantities. So when it is in huge amount of that, it has multi-dimension. Because of this multi-dimension, it is not scalar or vector, but it is basically the tensor. So tensor is the word which is derived from the features, because a data may have n number of features. If you take the example of fruit, it has various features: color, texture, size, shape, even origin and everything. So with a single data, you have number of things, and using array, using scalar vector theory, it will not work. You need multi-dimensional features, and that is why the technology of TensorFlow has been developed, by which we use for preparing our own training data. Training model. Deep learning model accepts input and generates output in the form of tensors. So that is what basically the trained model is all about. A tensor is essentially a list that contains either numbers or other tensors. When we download that model, it is a file having some sort of extension based on the technology we have used. If it is a Keras model, if it is a TensorFlow model, if it is a forgot the name. So it has different extensions. But when we will prepare a model for Arduino, Arduino does not support any other sort of model. Arduino supports libraries only, and usually libraries are in the form of .h file. So in case of tiny machine learning for Arduino, we will create a TensorFlow model, but we will transform this TensorFlow model to a header file. And finally, loading the header file into the Arduino, it will give you the real world application output. So tensor, like again explaining you in a very simple way, scalar is single quantity vector and then matrix, and then we have tensor. And tensor is not only limited up to this, which is shown in the figure, but it is multidimensional or higher dimension, more than that even, you can imagine. Coming back to the concept of CPU, GPU and TPU, is that we have CPU in most of the computers. Even in case of mobile phone computers, we have central processing unit. Graphical processing unit gives you a higher edge over computing large amount of data. Tensor processing unit is already different than the GPU and CPU, but in 99% cases, GPUs are used for data processing. Not looking at this slide, let me give you the last slide. Okay. Challenges for ML, that overbearing prerequisite systems knowledge for setting up the environment. That you will be able to accuracy you are trying to solve. I will explain this slide using a single example of many students, many faculty doing PhD on the X-ray data or maybe some sort of cancer data or MRI images or number of things. So what I want to convey here is that there is no boundary. There is no limit of bringing the accuracy or the result. Everybody has their own limitation. Simply looking at the physical outcome, physical example, that there is a doctor in the world who is considered to be one of the expert doctor who is having 40 years of experience in the life. He has almost experienced all type of cases in terms of diagnosing the things from the X-ray images or MRI images. So just look at the lifespan of that person who is having 40 years of experience. Every day he might have seen 500 X-rays or MRI images. So just count them, that 1000 images per day. So 1000 into 365 for 1 year. And just like that, it is up to 40 years. So total number of images that person, that doctor who is an experienced doctor, has seen is something around, say for example, 5 lakhs or maybe 20 lakhs or 25 lakhs. But when it comes to machine learning, you collect X-ray and MRI images from the world. It may be 1 billion images or maybe 40 billion images or say 1 crore images. You give all the images as an input to your machine learning algorithm. Once the model will get trained, you will see that the power of that particular AI system will be 1,000 times more than that an experienced doctor, because doctor has a limitation. Being a human being, we have limitations. We might not have seen the data. Even the doctor may be residing in, say, Delhi. He might have seen the X-ray images or MRI images for Indian subjects only, maybe in Asian subjects only, but not from the people of Argentina and Chile. So when you collect the information in terms of data set, you collect the images from the worldwide, every country or maybe different regions of the world. So you have variety of the data also in terms of data set. And when this sort of data is being used, the accuracy of the model will be so high as compared to human being also. So that is why many a times people say that AI will take jobs and AI will take this thing and that thing. But never forget, AI is not going to take any job. AI is going to cover, AI is going to kill definitely number of jobs. But the important thing is we need people who are able to develop all these applications. So this is the time that we need to little bit switch from enhancing the skill to our electronics and communication by implementing and adapting all these new changes in the world, that how we can bring this technology to even hardware also. And that is why we have this example today. So when you want to make an IoT based machine learning project, you need to decide first of all that what is your goal to make the project for. Say for example, we are simply taking the example of accelerometer. That we have an accelerometer that actually monitors the earthquake activity, for example. In the seismographs, we have accelerometer, but they are different and they are known as geophone sensors. So geophone is basically a sensor inside the seismograph. It is not at all different than the accelerometer, but it is exclusively designed for earthquake applications. So it gives you different outputs continuously, even in daytime also, even in nighttime also, even then there is no earthquake, the geophone gives you some output. I have seen the live data of the geophone by which you are able to see that it is continuously giving you some output based on the earth's movement. And even the external thrust or maybe external variations on the earth's surface, it gives you the output. Now, if you want to make an AI application based on this sort of IoT devices, because these days even the seismographs are also part of IoT system, that throughout the world, all the seismographs are connected together through the cloud. And that is why we are able to get the data whenever there is an earthquake in the world. If you have subscribed the USGS agency, USGS is basically a United States geographical system. If you subscribe them, and if you subscribe having a customization that I want to get an email when there is an earthquake in Asian countries, and the Richter scale value should be greater than 6, then I should get this information. So whenever there is an earthquake, within a second, you will get a notification on your mobile phone that there is an earthquake in, say, for example, near Java, thing like that. But when the scale is 6. So this is a kind of an IoT system, basically, where information in your phone application from all this. So you need to decide what you want to do, what sort of applications you want to develop for IoT systems. Now the time is to collect the data set. As I told you that instead of using the data set, pre-ready-made data set from anyone's repository or maybe from GitHub or from university or from government website, it is better to create your own. In some of the cases, you may not get the data directly until and unless you have an access to develop those data. But even the data are available from various resources which you can use for your own educational purpose. But once you want to make a professional product, you definitely need your own data, because again, it's a case of copyright and everything. On Kaggle.com, lots of data are available open source. You can definitely use them for your purpose. Then design a model and architecture, train the model, convert the model, run inference. Run inference is basically that header file which you are transferring to the Arduino, and evaluate and troubleshoot on the model itself. So there are some creative and innovative examples of machine learning for physical computing using microcontrollers already available on the internet. I have tried to demonstrate some of the glimpse of those things. That, see, there is a gesture movement of fingers, and based on that, the person is able to do something, because there is an Arduino Nano inside that plastic box, which has some sort of proximity sensor by which you are able to identify something, that there is a movement. Even the gesture movement also is identified. And based on that, mobile application is able to do that, switch on and off the details. In this case, the person is able to explain something in terms of astronomy. In this example, you can play the game just by the gesture, because it has been already trained. This is a rock, paper, scissor game. By doing various gestures from the finger itself, you are able to switch on and off, and you can play the game that how you can do rock, paper, scissor. These are some of the examples of machine learning on the embedded system, that NVIDIA Jetson Nano. You can see that there is a JetBot. JetBot is basically a complete kit which provided by the Jetson family. There is a board, there is a camera, there is a power bank, there are some motors and wheels and everything, and you can make an autonomous vehicle. Jetson, NVIDIA Jetson has actually provided a very good example of making your own autonomous vehicle in the room. So you need to simply play the car or run the car in the room, take various photographs, obstacles and everything, prepare a data set, and then now you put your car freely running in the room, it will be definitely able to understand everything because you have already trained. The similar technology what Tesla and other big car companies who are involved in autonomous vehicle are right now developing. So this is one of the best example of machine learning on the embedded system, that it gives you all the power of machine learning on that. Raspberry Pi is also one of the very handy and very popular embedded system board by which you can develop machine learning based applications on that. But only thing is that it is not having any GPU inbuilt into that. So you need to train your data outside, inside the computer, and then deploy the model directly on that. Otherwise, the temperature of Raspberry Pi will go very high, and sometimes I have observed that it goes to 92 degree also, and it will get heated up. So do not try to run the model, train the model on that. Now, there are some other available boards specifically which has the support for machine learning to deploy. It's Intel pattern making technology, which you can run on even Arduino. Even you can use the various patterns and using the accelerometer, and you can run them. This is one of the available kit. This is also available in India on Amazon, which is a vision kit and voice kit. So actually, Google has developed this sort of kits for school students that they can even make computer vision applications and voice-based application. They have actually deployed a Google Assistant into the hardware, which is provided into this, and you can even do number of applications. It does not require any programming. You need to simply train in a different way with the data which you have. This is one of the powerful board for IoT applications. Specifically, it is known as a Google Coral board. It has a GPU power. So it is a kind of a stick which is available, which can be connected even with the Raspberry Pi also using the USB port. And even you can make your Raspberry Pi a powerful machine learning hardware by which the Raspberry Pi on most of the Indian web. Now, this is one of the example of pose estimation and image recognition in most of the AI and machine learning models. This is one of the very good example of Google Teachable Machine. Those who are acquainted with the Google Teachable Machine, that it is very popular among kids even today, that you are able to make any application which is machine learning application without any softwares, without any data set. You can create a train model within a fraction of time. Even you can transfer to your mobile phones into an Android application, or maybe you can transfer it to any of the hardware which you have. So I will suggest you to explore all these various technologies which are available. Now, what is the difference among all these previously discussed machine learning technologies and this ML embedded system is that the only difference is low cost and low power, and that is why we need to be very much careful that we have some sort of limitations on this, because anyway, when we are talking on the hardware, we have lots of constraints. So very popular board, again, from the SparkFun. It is a kind of a SparkFun edge board. It has some camera also, like Himax camera is provided with that. It is able to run the TensorFlow model on the hardware itself. You can make applications like person detection and magic wand, like what we see in the Harry Potter movies. This is by STM Electronics, which also helps you to run the TensorFlow models on the hardware. It has a display also. This is by Adafruit. It's a edge-based Adafruit board, and which is known as Adafruit TensorFlow Lite for microcontrollers. It has even microphone inbuilt into that. So you can do some sort of micro speech applications also. You can identify even the language which you speak. So you can develop some sort of machine learning algorithms by which you are able to identify the language of a person, what the person is speaking. And this sort of ML applications can be developed. This is, I think, available right now in the market. When I prepared that, it was coming soon, so I have written. But it is a BrainCraft hat for Raspberry Pi. So it is a kind of a shield which you can apply on the Raspberry Pi and can be used for identifying the object detection. So usually we do object detection in computers, but if you want to do object detection on this sort of embedded systems, you want to fit this system into a CCTV camera, and that is possible. So these days we might have seen that Godrej has actually a doorbell system in India, which gives you an access of camera from outside your door, and inside your home, you can see that who the person is outside the home and waiting for door to open. So you can see the camera image or the live video feed of that person who is outside the door, outside the home. Definitely, you can run this sort of machine learning into that, so you can even identify that who the person is, whether you want to allow door to open automatically, or even you can add some creativity. Like these days, we want to see that whether the person is wearing mask or not. So you can create a person is wearing mask or not. You can prepare a data set on Google Teachable Machine and then make a model and directly deploy it onto that. So you will come to know that tamara ghar ni bahar koi manas ubo hase, person is wearing mask or not, the system will alert you inside the home that the person standing outside the home is not wearing a mask, and definitely you can take actions based on that whether you want to allow it or not. This is the hardware which I will use today, Arduino Nano 33 BLE Sense. Again, looking at some of the features very quickly because we are running out of time. It has 9 axis internal sensor. It can be used as a wearable sensor also, so you can make a device which you can wear, like similarly what we wear as a smart wristwatch today. There are lots of wristwatch available in the market, and all the watches starting from Apple to Galaxy Gear to the Amazon Fit, or a number of watches are available. All of them are having the same concept of using accelerometer data. They have trained the models, they have deployed the models onto the watch, and they are able to detect anything. So if you start walking, your watch will tell you that, okay, you are walking and these are the steps. You might have observed that even the Samsung phone or maybe any other phone applications are also able to identify the how many steps you have walked today. If you just move your phone, something like that, it will not count the steps. Why? Because the machine learning model is so smart and it has been trained like that. When the person is walking, the data has been recorded for training data set, and that has been used for training the model. And finally, that is why it is so much accurate. If you were phone, 50 or steps do not count. So that is what the intelligence is all about. It has humidity sensor, it has temperature and barometric pressure sensor, microphone, gesture sensor is one which I forgot to mention. So gesture sensor is simply like how some movement is happening near to this board. So if you move your hand from left to right, it will be able to identify that, okay, you are moving something from left to right, from right to left, from up down, from close to far. All these gestures are this sensor is able to identify. Light sensor is one of the sensor which gives you the intensity of red, green and blue in a different sense. Say for example, in other computer based object detection algorithms, we have seen that the computer camera is able to identify banana or apple or something like that. But in this case, it does not have camera. This board does not have camera, but you want to see that, you want to identify the fruits, whether it is banana or whether it is tomato, whether it is apple. Using the RGB sensor, you need to simply take the data by keeping the RGB sensors near to the fruits and take the data output from the Arduino, record them, train them, and then run them. So definitely it will be able to identify. Definitely it will not understand the yellow color of the shirt and yellow color of the banana, but it will definitely tell you it's a banana when you will show something which is yellow. So this is also one of the example which you can make out of all this. It has flash memory of 32 kilobytes and SRAM is of 2 kilobytes. So now you can understand that there are some limitations into this board. So can you imagine what can be the model which we will upload onto this board? It will be simply around 8 KB to 12 KB of size. So 8 KB of model is a very small model which we run on the Arduino Nano for all these things. Now you can add a camera to the Arduino board because there are some cameras available for some sort of real world application of computer vision, person detection, magic wand or micro speech, because it has microphone on this microphone che ahiya che aaj hu chip ni baju ma batau chu, that is basically the microphone on that. So there is a very good example which is a kind of a ready made example provided with the board itself, that you speak something like yes or no. There is a model which you can load into the Arduino Nano, and based on that it will identify. So if you write Arduino program, that if somebody says yes, it will be green, or if it is no, it will be red. So this is an example of running the speech model on the small hardware. The size of the model is around 12 KB. This is a kind of a gesture recognition, that you do some gestures and the icons will appear on the screen. If you push, if you pull, if you punch, you will be able to get all these gestures accurately printed on the computer screen. So let me show you if I can do it in within 10 minutes. So first of all, this is the board. I think it is visible to all of you.
Yes, sir, visible. Yes, sir,
visible. Okay. So I have shared a screen of Arduino Nano in which there is a very small program which is a ready-made example which comes with the hardware itself to get the sample data for the sensor. So just look at some of the few lines where we have added the header file for library for this accelerometer and gyroscope sensor, which is a Texas Instrument sensor. So they have the library into this LSM. Need to include the temperature value. So we have defined some variables like that and GX. GY, GZ, basically the acceleration in Z direction and the angular motion in the X, Y, and Z direction. Then we are actually printing all these value on the screen itself. So let me show you if I can run this. And this is just to record the data. Serial mode. So I'm transferring this program. This is a program just to collect the data. So when we are trying to prepare the data set, we have to collect various data from the sensor. Vaivana divse student no project chalto no hoy em lecture ma pan kadach evu thatu hoy. So let us hope that it will get loaded and I will be able to show you something. It is compiling the sketch and then okay, it's done. So the program is loaded. Now let us just look at the serial plotter. You see the board rate, it is 9600. Screen. So here we will be able to see the real-time values of acceleration. Actually, I forgot to, I simply compile, I forgot to upload to the board, and now it's being happening. Apparently, what I can do right now, it's being loaded, but currently there is a program which is running inside this board, is classification of particular data which has been trained and it has been loaded. So if I can show, it will actually classify what gesture I'm doing right now. So if it works, let me show that. CL monitor. Let us wait for this program to load first and then we'll see. So it has started uploading now. It has got uploaded too. Okay, so now looking at the serial plotter, it gives some error. What is the problem with Arduino Nano BLE is that whenever you upload the program and you want to open the serial monitor or serial plotter, you have to select the board, the port again. So it actually loses the port connection. So again, selecting the COM port 4 and now plotting this data. So you are able to see that there is a real-time data which is being plotted. Right now, I'm not moving anything. So if you look at the sensor data, I will do some sort of gestures. Say, for example, I'm doing right side movement. So this is right. Again, this is right. Again, this is right. Again, this is right. So now you can see that there is some sort of common pattern which is being generated inside the due to the accelerometer data, because XYZ position is going to remain same when you are holding the sensor. So this is like this. So now if I do something, say doing a circle, again doing a circle, again doing a circle. So this movement will give me some sort of data which we can see from the monitor also. So in this monitor, we are actually getting lots of information. So in this case, we are not able to identify what the data is all about. But we definitely know that how we have printed it on the serial monitor. And say, for example, the first value, which is 0.500 minus 0.209. So this is AX, AY, AZ, GX, GY, and GZ. we need to simply collect all these data for our training data set. Say for example, I want to record the data for doing a gesture for writing two. So when I write two, it actually generates lots of data. Again, writing two generates again lots of data. Again, writing two. So do it for 100 times, 500 times. Collect all the data for one gesture, like two. Once you get all the data, transfer them into a CSV comma separated value Excel file. And then you have the complete data set for gesture two. Give the name that 2.csv. Do it for gesture three. Do it for 500 times, 1000 times. The more the data you have, more the for different gestures. We have not downloaded. If you want to make a very smartwatch application using this sort of Arduino Nano that you want to identify whether the person is sleeping or not. તમને ખ્યાલ હશે તો પેલી wristwatch માં આવે છે કે રાતના સમયે તમે સૂતા છો. Your sleeping patterns and sleep movements, whether your sleep was good or not. So it was, the data were collected similar to like this only, that you wear this Arduino Nano and sleep all for the whole night and the data will get recorded. Tamari ratni movement thase, mujab data store thase, and based on that movement, if the person is continuously moving in the night and the sleep is not sound or something like that. So we have to collect first all these data and just to look at the view that how they are differentiated. Maybe if you want to use even unsupervised learning, you can do that. But just to understand that all the gesture patterns are literally different. Say for three, I'm doing it for three. It is almost similar. You can see that there are three different blocks of sensor data. Now, if I'm rubbing something, say for example, doing something like this. So it is very easy to identify the patterns. Now, the important part is that making some sort of IoT application, this is just an example of accelerometer. You can take temperature data, you can take microphone data, you can take n number of data for any sort of application. If you want to be more innovative and more creative, what you can do is that you can collect microphone data for various sounds and noise. Put this microphone on a road with this Arduino Nano and collect all the road sounds, like noisy sounds of the vehicles and everything. And even you can identify the vehicles also, whether it is truck, whether it is car, whether it is scooter, whether it is human movement, whether it is a sounding of horn or something like that. You collect all the data samples. You need to do it for say 7 days, 1 month, 2 months, collect all this data and then prepare your own data set. Making a machine learning algorithm is very easy because there is a predefined strategy to do that. You can take TensorFlow, you can prepare a convolution neural network and then train on the Google Collaboratory. Details and everything are provided on the internet. There is no need to learn anything. Because of this constraints on the time, I'm not able to right now show you the Google Collaboratory also, but that is very easy to understand and identify from the internet. So once we transfer this gesture, right now this was simply for collecting the data. Now, what I want to show here is that I will be transferring the program for identifying that which gesture it was. So I'm loading the program for IMU classifier. That is basically classifying the data now. The first program was for simply the data collection. So let me load this model and let us see what happens. So actually what I had done is that I had collected various data for gesture 1, 2, 3, 0, etc. and then prepared a data set and then it was trained and modeled like header file, which you can see here on the IMU classifier tab. This is basically the header file. So these calculations are basically the trained calculations of the data set which we had prepared. Aikaj header file, that is basically our model, which actually gives an access to the machine learning part. Now let us see the monitor part and I will do some sort of gesture and it will be able to identify it properly. I have done it for ABC, something like that. So if I do gesture A, it is showing me C. Let me do A. If I write B, if I write C, actually just because of the lagging, it shows a different character, but it is accurately trained. So you can see the accuracy also, that A is 0.97, B and C is 0.00 and 0.02. It means that the accuracy of those things is predicted less. So finally, it will print something like A and B and C, etc. Again, doing some gestures like this will give me some answers. So this is, I think, finished because I have a lecture and so I would like to share something and then. So over to you, Ghanshyam.
Yes, sir. Very informative, sir. And we'll have a demonstration even. Sir, we can wait. Participants having any query?
Yes, please.
Their self. Yes, participants.
Yes, participants.
Queries. You can ask. Okay,
please,
sir.
Please ask the question. Please ask the question.
And even you can drop the question in chat box.
Do I have access to question chats?
Yes.
Okay, let me see that.
Right now we don't have any.
Okay, no problem. So if anyone is having a question, they can definitely ask. I will be happy to help and answer.
And sir, YouTube channel. So any queries from the
so
we will follow. It was a wonderful session. Informative. And thanks. Practical demonstration. So once again, department and organ. I would like to thank you for giving your hosting. Thank you, Kiran sir. And we are going to meet session on.
There is a question, sir. Which type of algorithm is best to implement face recognition? There is something like a CNN part which you can use for the face recognition or identification. It is not directly any ready-made algorithm which you have to use, but you need to simply collect your own data, and based on all these data, you can do face recognition and face detection. I would like to give an example that 1 year back, I had guided one BE project in which what we did, actually, we had collected the sample photographs of the class students of 8th semester, and their photographs were taken in a different style, like in different situation, in different clothes and different situation. So the data were trained using the enrollment numbers. So every student's data set, like 100 photographs of a single student, the face photographs of the student was given an enrollment number into one folder, and different data were prepared. What we did finally, that we created a system of Raspberry Pi and camera that when a student comes in front of the camera, the person or the student will be identified based on the enrollment number. And this enrollment number will fetch the result of the student from GTU website. So when a student comes in front of the camera, you will be able to see that the Raspberry Pi actually speaks out the result that, okay, you have 8 CGPA or maybe you have 3 backlogs or something like that. So it is not that much interesting in terms of simply developing the face recognition system, but you add some creativity to this sort of things so that it will be very much catchy and useful also in real world application. Okay, sir. Sir, over to you. Ghanshyam, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot. I'm leaving this now because I have a lecture right now.
Okay, sir. Thank you once again, sir. We please for the upcoming session. Thank you, all of you.